On tonight's Arizona ArtBeat, we give a nod to the start of the 2012 Phoenix Open by taking a look at the art of golf course design. Joining me is Forrest Richardson, a Phoenix-based golf course architect and the author of four books on golf course design. Good to see you. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Good to be here.
We talk about the art of golf. There is an art involved, isn't there?
There is. There's art, there's science, and there's also the game. So it's really three elements, but the art is an important part of it.
I know you've described it as golf. It's a sculpture. It's like a massive sculpture.
It is. Most people see one hole at a time. You're in an airplane, you can be 30,000 feet, 20,000 feet, and see the whole course, but most people don't appreciate it that way. But what I do, of course, I have to look at it that way and the individual hole.
How do you do that? Let's say you start with a plot of land. I want a bunker here. I want a tee shot. How do you do that?
I wish it were that easy. It can be sometimes if you have the right site. But it all begins with the land and appreciating what the land has to offer. Many of our modern golf courses didn't have, they weren't built on the beautiful, fields of Scotland and the Lynx land and whatever. So we've had to create in the last generation of golf courses the interest. So the TPC course out is an example of a completely man-made environment, but nonetheless one that's very beautiful and has a lot of, as you know, spectator opportunities.
Sure. To see the game. So when you design it, you can see from the ground, you can see the fairway from the ground, you can kind of see overhead how it looks. I mean, can you get that in your mind? You have to draw it out. How does it work?
We draw it. We spend a lot of time on the land. We spend time with the mapping, the topographical maps, the aerial photos, and so it's a combination of things. But in the end, it's all about trying to make it fit not only the land, but also fit the region and the culture. So a golf course, for instance, in Phoenix is a lot different, as most people know, from a golf course in Minnesota, mm-hmm. or one in Mexico, or one in Europe.
And also fit the ability of, I would think, your yep. average golfer, because right. for a time there, they were building courses that were ridiculously difficult.
Well, the game's supposed to be fun, and I mean, this is something that we say all the time, is, and that probably has turned people away from golf, is the fact that we've maybe made courses too hard. So the best thing is to come out of it with a golf course that challenges the best players, but is really enjoyable for the casual golfer.
Let's talk about the history of golf, and we have some photos here, including the first one, which basically shows probably what the first golf course design
That's Askernish in the Outer Hebrides of Scotland, and that is a golf course that in the last few years has been rediscovered. It was closed during World War II, and it is just a beautiful old Tom Morris course that literally was reminiscent of the way courses would have been in the 1600s and whatever.
And now we got St. Andrews is next, the old course of St. Andrews. That's what people think of when they think of old courses.
And that's really where the first seed of golf course design was born. In the late 1700s, they decided to change the old course from 22 holes to 18.
Interesting.
No one knows exactly why. It could have been slow play or just that the town was growing. But that was the time when all of a sudden the handprint of man was brought to golf courses.
And you talk about the handprint of man. Our next photo shows that these golf courses, in some respects, were pretty close to buildings and towns and roads and the whole
thing. They were like the greatest ski lodge and resort you could ever imagine. You finished golf and you were right there at the pub and the restaurant and the where you'd spend your time. But what happened is when golf came to the United States in America in the late 1800s, we didn't really know what they were supposed to look like. So the my predecessors, the people that started designing courses, mm-hmm. would create these manufactured looks. And so Oakmont in Pennsylvania is an example of a very archaic looking golf course. Not a lot natural about it. A lot of man-made features.
Yeah, that does not look normal, that man standing in that sand trap.
Those are the church pews, the famous church pew bunkers.
Yeah, that's good for them. Our next one is Robert Trent Jones.
Well,
he's known. He is the Forrest Richardson of golf course design.
Well, Mr. Jones, Trent as we called him, of course he has two sons that now have carried on his work, Reese and Bobby. But the wigwam, which is this picture, very typical of that post-World War II golf being built everywhere in the United States, Firestone, the wigwam, and the 60s and 70s were just rich with build more, build more, build more.
And signature courses, meaning people know by certain details who built
right.
this course.
Mr. Jones coined the phrase a signature golf course. He also said, hard pars, easy bogeys. So it's another talk about.
Yeah, that's why I'm not sure I'm all crazy about that one. We have a picture here of the seventh hole at Stone Harbor, and this looks an awful lot like another signature par three.
Well, Desmond Muirhead was one of the truly right brain, out there thinking gentlemen in golf course design. And in the 80s, Desmond created these really wild symbolistic courses, and he did a lot of them in Indonesia and Japan, but a few in the United States. Unfortunately, Stone Harbor doesn't survive. All of the work that he did there has pretty much been tamed down. But nonetheless, it was a time in golf course design when the art was really brought to a completely different level.
And when you see the Sawgrass, the par three at Sawgrass, which everyone, all golfers at least, are familiar with, that's the one that
Pete and Alice Dye, and that's what really was the precursor to the TPC course in Scottsdale, where we all of a sudden were creating courses for spectators.
Let's look at some of your courses, starting with the Arizona Grand. Now, when you designed this course, you got such a beautiful scenery to work with. What do you try to emphasize on a course like this? And secondly, how do you keep it from standing out like a sore thumb in the beautiful desert environment?
Well, it was a tough assignment. It was very controversial at the time because we were using land that was adjoining and in the Phoenix Mountain Preserve. But it turned out to be a win-win because we've created new habitat for the park, so the exchange of land brought more land to the park. But it's really all about integrating it with the land, taking advantage of those great views, taking advantage of the terrain, and making it feel like it's been there for 100 years.
Got the Hideout in Utah, same kind of thing, only the high country here. Which, is it easier in high country or more difficult?
It's more difficult because you have a shorter growing season and you have other constraints. Again, the idea is to really fit the land to the golf and have the golfer feel they're in an environment just like when people see Pebble Beach on TV, mm-hmm. or they see any famous golf course. They it's all about the land.
And Las Palomas and Rocky Point, Mexico, I've played this particular course, and you got the wind down there, and this is like a Lynx course down there.
It's a Lynx course, and that particular hole, there was virtually nothing done to it, so it wasn't so much about designing, but going back to the very first slide you saw where the golf course was found and discovered, as opposed to actually being created.
Okay, last, we got about a minute here, so let's hit you with this one. Critics say golf courses, they waste water. There's too many of them out there. They're a poor use of land. Leave things in their natural state. What do you say when people say that?
Well, and to some degree, those are fair comments. However, most golf courses, not all of them, but most golf courses out here use reclaimed water. In Hawaii, when we build golf courses, in fact, they want us to put more turf in because the land is so porous that having the reclaimed water filtered by the plant is a very positive thing. And then most golf courses anywhere are serving a purpose of open space. They're serving for drainage. They're a golf course has enough oxygen produced, you know, to maintain a city of about 10,000 people. So golf courses are sustainable open space, and if they're designed properly and built properly, they can be terrific neighbors to communities.
All right. Very good. Forrest, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.